submerged library that we then eventually find out the sugar bowl is at the bottom of.
The sugar bowl. Hey guys, happy new year!
Happy new year!
Yay! I'm back with my friend Sarita.
Hi guys!
Makeup guru, social media manager, a series of unfortunate events super fan expert.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. So you know, today we're talking about A Series of Unfortunate Events, Season 3, the final season. And I was like, I need to bring an expert in. I love the show, but I don't know everything. And Sarita, she's got all the books, she knows it all. Mm-hmm. So this is our resident expert today.
Yeah, I'm really excited. I think if there's anything that I love more than Michael Langdon, is A Series of Unfortunate Events. I've actually been reading the book since I was 13, like, bought all the other books. So, like, when the series came out, I was so excited, because this is the first time that someone, like, after the dismal movie, someone actually, like, made something that's beautiful, great to watch. So the first two seasons, I absolutely loved it. So we're gonna dive right into the third season and final season.
So at the beginning of the season, we start right where we left off with Klaus and Violet careening off the slippery slope, Count Olaf, and them just kind of continuing going back and forth, mm-hmm. trying to figure out more about VFD, and everything kind of culminates at the end of this season.
In the slippery slope, from the jump, we find out who is the survivor of the fire. And it's not what everyone thinks it is, that one of the Baudelaire parents are alive.
That would be cool.
Actually Quigley Quagmire, who is the triplet, who is suspected to be dead in the Quagmire fire, but he's not, he's alive.
Going into it, I had a feeling that it was Quigley. Quigley, mm-hmm. but that's his name, right? Quigley. I that sounded really weird when I said it. Quigley.
Quigley is a
Quigley.
Weird name.
It is a weird name. Who else could it be? And he sounded so young.
Yeah.
So I was like, I think this is it. So that one didn't surprise me. But there was definitely other things that happened this season. Mm-hmm. That I was like, what?
Yeah.
So in the slippery slope, we also were introduced to the man with no hair and a beard, and the woman with no beard and hair.
They're introduced very late in the series, but they are on what people say the bad side of the schism. They're like responsible for a lot of like really bad stuff, and this is the first time we ever see Count Olaf like truly scared.
Being able to see Count Olaf in this more like vulnerable state, I feel mm-hmm. like actually made you kind of feel for him this season. Like, you kind of learned a lot more about his backstory. He really is seeking approval from people and doesn't have a family figure, and that kind of, I think, really moves the story along.
Now we see who he's trying to seek approval from.
Yeah.
You know, why he has to put on such a tough act, you know, and why he tries to make himself scarier than we actually find out that he really is.
Mm-hmm. And I think something else that I really loved about the slippery slope was that we kind of started to learn more about these henchmen mm-hmm. that are following Olaf, and they're kind of like, you know what? We don't know why we're doing this. Like, you know, we wanted to be in a theater troupe, and they turned into something else.
Yeah.
Especially the Hook Hand Man, who had this really incredible backstory that I was very surprised to learn about.
The whole book, like, he is Olaf's scariest henchman. You know, he is the one who shows no sympathy. And in the books, he doesn't have a relationship with Sunny like we do see in the series.
Yeah, I think they did a really great job of making you feel for him. You know?
Yeah. It's really funny and cute that there's their storyline.
Speaking of Sunny, like, we get to see a lot of really cute moments with this baby.
She's
so cute.
Up.
That one moment in Slippery Slope where, you know, she's with Violet and mm-hmm. she's locked in a cage again.
Again.
Another bird cage. She's like, I'll stay and be a spy.
Yeah.
And they're like, well, how are you gonna get out?
Yeah.
And she like ties her little hair up just like Violet.
She's learning. The sweetest thing ever. Like, the sweetest. Like, I cried during that scene for some reason. I guess it's like after so many years seeing Sunny, you know, grow up in front of your eyes. Like, I feel like that is just like is one of my favorite scenes ever.
Let's get into the Grim Grotto a little mm-hmm. bit. And speaking of the Hook-Handed Man that we were talking about and his backstory, it turns out that he has a sister named Fiona who we're introduced to, but we don't know that they're related at the time.
Yeah.
And it was just really cool to learn about how he got his hook hands and his whole backstory and to see that, you know, he does seem like he's a good guy. I think something that was a big theme in this season and not even in just this season, but in the show in general, is mm-hmm. that kind of not everything is what it seems like. Mm-hmm. Not everyone is noble or wicked, and mm-hmm. I think with him you really got to see that.
You find out more details with him and Gregor and Whistle, and what Gregor was trying to do versus what Fernald was trying to do. You know, and in the books it's never revealed how he loses his hands and becomes a Hook Hand Man, but I think that, again, things that the book couldn't achieve, the series does, so I think that's really good. And also it's interesting to note that this, when they get on the Queequeg, no Captain Wittershins. It just starts off with Fiona. It kind of goes a little backwards with his storyline, because he was in the books as this big, booming, boisterous character that's Fiona's stepfather, and then he disappears at the end of the book and no one knows where he goes. Whereas in the series, he isn't there, and then eventually we hear about him in the end.
I like that they focused on Fiona. I think it was cool to see another young female character of color mm-hmm. come in and kind of be the captain and, mm-hmm. you know, be really smart.
The one thing I will note with the Grim Grotto episodes, that right off the bat, we see something that I did not think that we were going to see yet. In the books, you see Count Olaf's submarine disappearing and panicking and running away because they see a question mark on the radar. This is the second time you see him get really, really scared, and he just completely flees. He does not explain what the great unknown is. When you read All the Wrong Questions, which is a supplement series about Lemony Snicket's childhood, that is actually the abominated beast. And then you know that it's like this beast that like runs the sea, and actually we see the statue that's a big part of All the Wrong Questions in the end when they're going through all their stuff that they find washed up ashore. So I feel, and I really, really do hope that it could be like a spinoff.
That would be really cool.
Because we see Kit battling the beast again at the end of The Penultimate Peril.
The fact that they brought it up at least 3 or 4 different times in this series, I think it would be really cool to see them like kind of spin off and do something related to that, especially since it is a whole, what, like 4 book series mm-hmm. that they could actually dive into and adapt into a TV show.
Another thing I would like to note for people who absolutely love the books, the end of the Grim Grotto, when the kids are leaving the Gregorian Grotto, Lemony refers that there's a swimming lady in the background, which I really, really did hope that the series was going to show, and that could potentially be like Kit, because they had Kit running around the forest earlier. But I actually, a lot of people suspected that that was Aunt Josephine, you know, that if she was still alive, or like, who is this lady? You know, I thought that Jacqueline might show up again, because it kind of alluded that there are people and VFD members around them that are watching out and protecting them without them even knowing. So I really wish that they kind of played up on that. To me, that was a little bit of a miss.
I think also when we get to The Penultimate Peril and like the trial that's going on there, mm-hmm. they show all these people that we've never seen before that they say have been following them, that are like other VFD members. Mm-hmm. And I think it would have been really cool, kind of like how in The Haunting of Hill House, there mm-hmm. was all those ghosts hidden in the background.
Yeah.
It would have been cool if like, if you looked really carefully, there was like different VFD members. Mm-hmm. But I don't think they did that.
Yeah.
And especially since we didn't get that swimming lady moment. I personally, I don't know why, but I thought that all the people that we thought disappeared, like Uncle Monty mm-hmm. and Aunt Josephine and people like that, I thought they were all gonna come back.
Oh.
And I was hoping that like maybe those people had been like watching them and making sure that they were okay and just had to like pretend to die to go mm-hmm. undercover or something.
Yeah.
But then that didn't happen, so.
I know, she didn't read the
book. I didn't read the book, so.
One thing that I actually really appreciated so much with this show is how visually beautiful everything is. And yes. The Penultimate Peril really, really encapsulates Hotel Denouement. It really is beautiful. Like, you see all the details, the clock is like right on point, you know, even like a lot of the scenes were just completely on point.
The camera work was so beautifully done. The way they followed Sunny and Klaus and Violet as they kind of had to do their own individual things, it kind of felt a little bit choose your own adventure-y, where you kind of were like following them and following their little story. And it also kind of gave you this mystery that you weren't expecting, because you start realizing that they all happen to be with like one or two of the Denouement brothers at the same time, and you're like, wait a minute,
mm-hmm.
what is going on
here? It's one of those things, again, where in the show, it's a running thing that everyone's kind of like triplets in the series. Everything, all good things come in three. Dewey Denouement has always been like a mystery. Like, no one's ever seen him. People assume that he's dead. And the fact that he's like Kit Snicket's baby daddy is even better.
That was crazy. I was so confused, because I was like, wait a minute, is she dating like Ernest the bad guy.
Yeah. You know, when they find the secret library and Dewey like just shows up, the whole entire like library system based off the Dewey Decimal System. So that was the whole thing.
Uh-huh.
And so him being part of it, that was like the biggest get, because he was the one who created the submerged library that we then eventually find out the sugar bowl is at the bottom of.
The sugar bowl.
Rip Larry your waiter. Like, he was like the most original character. He was not in the series like that, like how he is in the show. He's always been there for the Baudelaires, so it's kind of funny that like he gets his just desserts, which sucks because Olaf's been after him for such a long time.
Now, did we get to learn more about him in the books?
No, Larry your waiter is actually just a waiter from the Anxious Clown.
But then he wants to help people.
Yeah.
Kind of how like Justice Strauss wants to help people and Olivia Caliban.
Yeah, he's an extended character, which again, I don't mind this extended character being in there, because I think they added characters in there that really encapsulate what VFD means as someone who's willing to take up the torch. One of the quotes in the book says, you know, any good and decent person knows when it's time to volunteer. I think that that is just kind of like who Jacqueline Larry represents.
That's really cool, because it's kind of like this message of anybody can like take a stand and help people, whether you're a super secret spy at a boarding school or just like a waiter, you know, like that anyone can make a difference. I think that's a nice message. Now, did you know going into it that JS was Justice Strauss, or like, did you think that they might change things, or who did you think JS was gonna be?
Originally in the books, Justice Strauss and Jerome Squaller show up at the same time. So because they show up at the same time, viewers like, oh, you're both JS. You know, so it's not Jock Snicket.
There's a lot of JS's,
I guess. I thought that Jock Snicket was alive.
I thought either that or that Jacqueline was.
She was organized and everything, which makes more sense. If they did that, I think that would make absolute sense. I think getting rid of her character too early is a good or bad thing, because if they put her character in, she can ultimately change the entire storyline, because she's a very well-respected member of VFD. She is essentially the Duchess of Winnipeg. She's on the really good part of the schism and knows everyone, so she has a lot of connections. But Jacques Snicket obviously being alive would not be a good thing, because it kind of messes up the storyline. That brings me to the fact that Lemony Snicket shows up in this storyline is another big thing. Lemony does not show up at all. It's Kit who shows up at the end of the books and is there for the kids. In what we find out is that Lemony is surprised that these three kids are Beatrice's kids.
I mean, the books, it's just following him from the beginning, following them. Kind of how Justice Strauss was following them.
Yeah, that's how it should have been.
But in the TV show, it's kind of like he realizes later on, and he's looking back now, years later, trying to figure out their story. So that was definitely different.
It was definitely different. I think that it threw the whole thing for a loop. I thought when I saw the trailer that they were actually going to make it a bigger thing, and they were going to capitalize on Lemony being part of it more so that he could do more for the kids, and he did nothing. I think it was so unnecessary for putting him in the story.
Maybe it was kind of showing that like idea of people making mistakes and like people being noble versus wicked. Like, he didn't know and like made this mistake of leaving them behind, and now he regrets it, and that's why he's following them. So also in the penultimate apparel we get to learn more about Olaf.
We've always known a little bit about Count Olaf. He is said to be a distant relative of the Baudelaires. We find this out through Lemony Snicket's dialogue at the beginning of the chapter, is throughout the story. That's the reason why I don't really believe that Lemony Snicket can research about Baudelaire's lives much late in the storyline, because he's very well aware. He insinuates something about poison darts. He insinuates a lot of like little storylines that we didn't figure out.
So they finally show us in the show.
Yes. I feel like Olaf blamed Lemony and Beatrice for such a long time about the poison darts.
And I mean, we got to see it. It was really Beatrice who did it. She didn't really mean to, I guess, but it was Beatrice, and Lemony took the fall for her because he loved her so much, and then that's why he went on Lem. So I think that's what caused the schism, right? I mean, like, they accidentally killed Olaf's dad.
Who's the chief of the official fire department, so that's a big thing.
And now he becomes an orphan.
Yeah.
And now there's all this chaos, Lemony's on the run, everybody hates each other.
But when you think about it,
it's all because Olaf's dad was killed.
I think it kind of makes sense that this is what caused the schism. I think that's just a really good understanding of what the schism really was about.
It's very personal. That's like, you killed this guy's dad, so now he's mad at your whole family, and he's gonna burn your house down and, you know, take your kid's fortune and
technically make the Baudelaires orphans.
Like an eye for an eye kind of situation now.
He has to be chasing the Baudelaires for another reason versus, you know, their fortune. Esme says, I have all the money in the world. Why would you want to chase around these three kids, kidnap them on individual accounts, just so that way you can wait so many years for them to turn of age and then steal their fortune?
You know what actually could be kind of an interesting theory is, like, yes, he wants to kind of get his revenge, but also maybe sort of like have this constant thing in his life finally, like have sort of a weird family. You know, they're always together, they're always kind of like having this back and forth because he doesn't have consistency in his life. His father died. He had these two people that kind of took him in as a mother and father figure, and then they didn't appreciate him, and now he is like, well, you know what, I want to get this revenge on the Baudelaires, but also maybe there's something kind of pulling him towards them because they are his distant relatives.
Yeah.
And you know, like, there's so many times when he could really hurt them and he doesn't really.
I also find it interesting that there is someone in his life that actually matters to him, and it's not Esme, it's actually Kit.
Yes, that was very surprising.
To a lot of people, it was very surprising. I think for people who are fans of the book, we were very surprised because we actually saw the opera scene. So we saw them being lovey-dovey.
And then going off of that, big surprise to me at least, I know you already knew.
It was still a shocker.
Count Olaf dies. I did not think that that was gonna happen. That death is where we really got to see Kit and Olaf and the relationship that they had previously and kind of like solidify that that was a thing. And it was like a sad death, and like they, even the kids, see, that's why I feel like there was some kind of like familial or like constant with the Baudelaires and Olaf, because they were kind of like sad that he was dead.
We find out that there is actually a side of Olaf that people can come to love, and like you said, he's constantly searching for validation and he's constantly searching for love, so it kind of sucks. I feel like him and the Baudelaires have a lot more in common than they think.
They made him more of a redeemable villain where you were like, oh, this this does get me my feels.
Yeah, I feel like Esme is way more evil than him.
So now it's been 13 years since the book The End came out. That's how long people have been waiting to find out what is in the sugar bowl.
Oh, God.
Now, okay, before we found out, what were your theories of what was in the sugar bowl?
I thought that it had to be a list of people who were on the good and bad side of the schism. The actual, like, what was in the sugar bowl wasn't something that, like, really, like, like, shook me. It was just kind of like, okay, well, they have other substitutes for it, you know?
Yeah, that's true. Okay, so what was in the sugar bowl was sugar! Which is, like, kind of funny because it's like, oh, sugar's
it's
in
like
the sugar bowl.
Clearly it's sugar, but
it's like a genetically modified sugar.
So it makes you immune to medusoid mycelium, which is like a big thing. It kind of sucks because it's like, okay, so we waited all this time for like us to know that. My thing is that, was it really that deep that Esme was chasing and wanted to kill Beatrice about this the whole entire time?
I don't think that she even wanted it because of what was in it. I think she just wanted the vole back because she is
the matching T-set.
So The End is the last episode. This was the only episode that had just one. The other ones were two-parters.
I feel gypped. I feel completely robbed.
I do
Netflix,
too.
Netflix, give me back $2 from my subscription account this month because I feel completely and utterly robbed. How dare they think that The End is not worthy of two episodes?
Yeah, I think that they really could have done two, and I wonder, maybe I'm getting to the whole conspiracy of like a series of unfortunate events and spies and stuff, but like, why would there only be one episode? I feel like it's weird to just do 7 episodes and not just do 8.
Yeah.
Like, was there a reason? Was the show not doing as well as they had hoped? Did the actors like not want to continue? I'm just confused about why they wrapped it up so quickly versus just like giving us a full 8 episode season.
Yeah.
So that's why, like, I want them to do a spinoff, but I don't know if they will. Like, I don't know.
It leaves you with so many questions that there are so many supplement books to this 13 book series that you would think that you find out what happens in the end. We meet Beatrice Baudelaire at the end of the end, right? And only like 5 minutes are dedicated to her, you know, meeting up with Lemony Snicket and actually sharing a root beer float with her uncle and talking about the Baudelaires. And for people who never read the Beatrice letters, keep hearing Lemony and Beatrice talk about was. The Baudelaires were, like, in the past tense.
We get to wrap up so many other stories at the end of this season.
The Quagmires.
The Queequeg with Fiona and Fernald on the submarine. Mm-hmm. But we don't get to find out actually what happened to the Baudelaires.
To the main characters!
I really thought that they were going to show us them as adults, maybe. Yeah. Because at this point, with Beatrice's age, they have to be a lot older. So yeah. I was like, are they going to get some older actors to play them?
Yeah.
What are they going to do? And the way that they went off with like the was and the were, mm-hmm. I was like, are they dead?
You're not making
are
this any better. It really was frustrating because in the end of the end, it looks like the Baudelaires and baby Beatrice sail off into happiness and going home.
Which is, where is home?
Where is home? Because they have no money, they have no anybody, you know, they can't go to Justice Strauss's house.
Like, who knows if anybody from the hotel even survived?
Nobody, we don't know. We really, really don't know. And it pisses all of us off because for people who have spent years, it's been 13 years since the end, the book was released. So it's been 13 years since we don't know what the hell happened to the Baudelaires.
Also, they must have like landed somewhere and like raised Beatrice for a little while, because otherwise,
if she's,
you know,
10 years old, someone has a fortune. Someone got the Baudelaire fortune. So where did they raise them? In the city? Did they get their own house? What did they do until they got the fortune? Baby Beatrice is trying to find and unsolve these mysteries, and we don't, as viewers, don't even get a chance to see that in the story.
That would actually be an interesting spinoff if they were to do one, like Beatrice mm-hmm. looking for the Baudelaires.
Yeah. As fans, I feel like, you know, even fans who, people who didn't read the book deserve to know what happened to the Baudelaires. Like, this is their only opportunity. Like a bitter end to the entire series, and really just makes it like no one gets true happiness, you know? And it kind
of
sucks.
Series of unfortunate events
for sure.
So to wrap it up, did you love this season?
I did. I think all in all, I love the season. I would watch all three seasons continuously, over and over again. I think the costume, the makeup, the lighting, the set design
is
so beautiful. I just love the whimsy and the exaggeration of the entire story.
That's my favorite part mm-hmm. about this whole series, is the whimsy and the exaggeration mm-hmm. and just how like quirky they get.
Yeah. I really loved it. I did.
Yeah.
I did. There's some things that I can't live with, meaning towards the end, but I think that all in all, it was good.
We would love to know what you guys think about A Series of Unfortunate Events Season 3 and just the whole series as a whole. What do you think about it compared to the books? Leave a comment down below and let us know. And if you have any theories that maybe we didn't catch, make sure to let us know, because we would love to check those out. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining me, Sarita, in my first video of the new year.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year! Check out Sarita's links in the description box below and go follow her. She is a makeup extraordinaire. Give this video a thumbs up if you liked it and click that subscribe button, because I come out with new videos every week. See ya!
Bye!